Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to another broadcast of Wealth and Wisdom with Fred Belcastro from the John DeVita Broadcast Center on the Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network and Jack FM 89.7 WRHS FM Norwich on Thursday, July the 20th, the year 2017. And now, here he is, Mr. Fred Belcastro.
When you're smiling,
and the whole world
smiles with you.
And when you're laughing,
and the sun comes
shining through.
When you're crying, you bring on the rain.
Stop your sighing.
Won't you be happy again?
When you're smiling.
Keep on smiling.
And the world will.
Good morning, and welcome to the Wealth and Wisdom Show. My name is Fred Belcastro, and I'm going to be your host during the next 30 minutes as we provide some financial clarity and so that you can create, cultivate, and keep your wealth in a tax-efficient manner. We are once again fortunate to be broadcasting from the John DeVita Broadcast Center here on the northwest side of Chicago. And this morning, this fine morning, John DeVita himself is directing our program. And you know, of course, you're listening to us this Thursday morning on Jack FM 89.7 WRHS out of Norridge, Illinois. And we talk each week about the difficulties that individuals have and the major challenges that they have in reaching full financial potential. Today's economic conditions have changed all the rules. All we have to do is turn on the radio or listen to the radio each day, and we know that even the rules in the state of Illinois, in Cook County, in the city of Chicago, and of course in Washington, D.C., everything's changing. And so some of the things that we grew up thinking that were true just doesn't seem to apply much today. Gosh darn it, conventional advice is simply not working. So we've got to re-educate ourselves, do a little bit of planning, and learn how money really works and how money really works today so that we can increase maybe our monthly saving without taking away from our lifestyle. And we're slowly coming to understand why focusing on the rate of return alone by itself will not yield the greatest results. We talk about how to keep more of your money by eliminating the necessary wealth I know it. You're sick of hearing me talk about the wealth transfers, but that's it, my friends. We're going to talk a little bit more about that this morning. So, it's not because we're not learning, we're not getting it, but because it's so awfully important. Growing your money systematically without increasing risk, that's what I'm talking about. Who wants to be able to do something with a little bit more risk, like the Willendas? You want to walk across a couple of buildings in a branch of the Chicago River on a tightrope? You want to take risk with your 401s, your pension, your basis of your livelihood over the next 20 or 30 or even 40 years? Because what I'm saying and what I've talked about thus far is the things that we were taught, the things that we learned, the things that we thought to be true about our money, that turns out not, 30 or 40 or 50 years later, not to be true. So if that's the case, do you really want to know about it? If we really discover that what we thought was true turned out not to be true, do we really want to know? And if we really want to know, the old saying is that we used to talk about, what are you going to do about it? You see? And this morning, I'll tell you what I'm going to do about it. I'm going to talk about a little bit about taxes and some of the examples of the wealth transfers. We just go right on doing it because we accept certain beliefs that we were indoctrinated with that simply are not true, simply do not work for us. Our taxes and how we pay our taxes. Now, I'll mention some of the reasons for having a plan. I'll tell you right off. When you look at the taxes, when you look at all the components of your tax bills, do you take the individual investments and deal with the taxation on those investments separately? Or do you have a tax preparer just lump it all together and tell you, this is what your taxes are? You're missing the boat. You should look at each, well, what we do when we do a plan is look at each individual investment by itself and minimize the tax, attempt to minimize the tax, sometimes alleviate the tax on that. I'm not talking about deferring it and putting it off. I'm talking about handling it and how do you make the application of that investment stand by itself and not just lump them together. How do we make our major purposes, these big ticket items? We talked about the Sal Polk and the interest expense that people pay on their purchases, their big ticket items, the stove, refrigerator, automobiles, and even how we pay our mortgage. But when we talk about saving money and trying to get ahead with money, and one strategy that always comes up, and it's a strategy that we're so accustomed to saying and using and adopting that it's natural. Well, if we want to save more, we've got to go on a financial diet. We've got to cut back on spending. Am I the only guy that talks about wealth transfers on the air? I listen to others and I hear about all these fantastic strategies and investments, and you've got to buy this kind of a product, that kind of a product. But am I the only guy that's talking about, hey, don't go on a diet? The thought of giving up something today to build for tomorrow is the only strategy some people really believe? Is that all that's available to you? The thought of it, just to think about having to give up what we want today, so stressful that it can keep us from taking any action at all. It brings up my friend Tommy Wilhelm. Do you remember, I don't know how many, years and years ago, I read a book called Seize the Day. It was by Bellow. Anyway, there was a protagonist in that story that put off making decisions. All of his life, he put off making decision after decision after decision. I think that's what we do sometimes when we take no action at all, because by taking no action at all, we're actually taking an action. We're actually ready to accept whatever befalls. You know, this brings us back to trying to find better investments. We got to find a better investment, better return. That's how we do it. That's how we make our money grow. Some time ago, I brought up the analogy or comparison of golfing. And sometimes I use that golf analogy to give us maybe a little clearer picture of the real problem. We move from financial product to another financial product. And this guy's got X, this guy's got X plus 2, this guy's got something else, this'll do it, yeah, this'll do it, yeah, this'll be the best, yeah. And we keep searching for the better return, the higher return. It's like buying new clubs. Remember the Big Bertha when that came out? I'm not a golfer, but I had an office with a fellow that played all the time. When I say all the time, the clubs and shoes are in the car. He couldn't drive to a call without going by a Stop and Sock or a golf course of some sort. But nevertheless, constantly buying new clubs to improve your game. Yeah, that'll do it. Now, I know that you've got to have good clubs. But the greatest impact on your game will come from perfecting your swing, won't it? See, the real answer to playing a good game of golf, I guess, aside from, now I'm not talking about cheating. There's no cheating, but just to protect the integrity of the game, is just to improve your swing. See, the answer is in the progress, in the process that you make, not the clubs, not the product. There's no, remember the silver bullet we talked about some weeks ago. There is no silver bullet. There's no one product. You know, people come up and ask me about individual product. There is none. You know, there's no one product. Otherwise, there would only be one product. You got 14,000 mutual funds out there. If there was a silver bullet, there'd only be one. But let me let me try to make it clearer for you. Let's just say you're going to play in the Masters, right? You're going to go down to Augusta, Georgia, and play in the Masters, a big, big, big golf tournament. You have two options available to you. Have you heard this before? Have I told you this before? Think about it. Think about it. Think about it. Mr. Mariani said, lead a horse to water, but you can't make them think. You've got to think. Two options available. You can have the clubs of any player who's ever played the game. Any player has ever played a round of golf. You can have his clubs, or you can have his ability. Which one would you choose? Obviously. Come on, that's silly, right? You'd want the ability. You'd want to be able to swing, like slamming Sammy Snead or any of the other golf greats. You see, the companies, the people that you hear talking constantly about getting better rates of return and fixing bad programs and everything else is offering you products. You know, we'll refer to those products as clubs. That's what I call. And you need the products. You need the clubs to play. But having the correct swing is a far greater value. Having the correct swing financially means that you've avoided throwing the money away, unnecessary wealth transfers. You know, making your money perform at its maximum potential, efficiently, doing all that it can do. Remember this, bad clubs, great swing, beat great clubs and a bad swing every single time. So when we focus on just increasing our wealth through higher investment returns, it's like trying to fill that leaky bucket by simply just pouring more water in faster than it leaks. Would you ever do that? Did you ever stop and think of what a doctor would do if he came upon a patient or a victim or of some sort, and the guy's bleeding and his leg is all busted up and everything else, and he goes, well, let's get some wood, let's get some tape, let's fix the leg. And they go, hey doc, look, the blood's pouring out of me, it's pumping out of me, it's all wet over here. You know, what would he do? What's the most, if you stop the bleeding. So when we're throwing money away, when we're throwing money away on the way we pay our mortgage, the way we finance our automobiles, the way we finance our education, the way we pay the mortgage, the way we use credit cards, the wrong types of insurance that we buy, the deductibles that we have, earning money in taxable investments we talked about several weeks ago. Stop bleeding. We wouldn't do that with a simple bucket analogy. We'd stop the we'd plug the leaks in the bucket. You see, if we plug the leaks in the bucket, the water, even if it's just a trickle, the bucket will flow very well, fill up very well. We got the taxes coming out. We're losing money on debt. We just pay a tax, whatever the accountant or the tax preparer tells us at the end of the year. We write the checks. Look at it. We've got a plan. If you don't have a plan, you think about fail to plan and plan to fail. You just don't plan the right way. All this information that we've been given about seeking better clubs isn't going to get you if you're bleeding. If you're bleeding money and the money's just going on debt expenses and taxes and interest payments. And unbelievable how we could be taught to look the other way. By avoiding these dollars that you're losing, you know, you're able to put more money into the bucket. You're able to accumulate more money. Look at all the money you would save if we didn't pay any interest. Didn't pay any interest at all. Would that help you? How about if we didn't pay any taxes at all? No taxes at all. It was legal not to have taxes. There were no more taxes, no more 16th Amendment. Would you have more money in your pocket? Why, certainly. But how about if we handled those expenses properly? You see? So when we look at individuals earning money or making money, let me give you an example on that. I'll have to go over to the blackboard. But in the meantime, let me take a cup of coffee and listen to Jimmy Brown. This was a song requested by a listener who had a death in the family. She wanted the song. To me, it was a sad song, but nevertheless, we said, okay, Kathy, here it is.
There's a village hidden deep in the valley, among the pine trees half forlorn. And there on a sunny morning, little Jimmy Brown was born.
Boom, 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 boom.
All the chapel bells were ringing
boom.
In the little valley town. The song that they were singing was for baby Jimmy Brown. Then the little congregation prayed for guidance from above. Lead us not into temptation, bless this hour of meditation, guide him with eternal love. There's a village hidden deep in the valley, beneath the mountains high above. And there, 20 years thereafter, Jimmy was to meet his love.
Boom, 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 boom.
All the chapel bells were ringing. T'was a great day in his life, 'cause the songs that they were singing was for Jimmy and his wife. Then the little congregation prayed for guidance from above. Lead us not into temptation, bless, O Lord, this celebration. May their lives be filled with love. From the village hidden deep in the valley, one rainy morning, dark and gray, a soul winged its way to heaven. Jimmy Brown had passed away.
Boom, 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 boom.
Just a lonely bell was ringing in the little valley town. 'Twas farewell that it was singing to our good old Jimmy Brown. And the little congregation prayed for guidance from above. Lead us not into temptation, may his soul find the salvation of thy great eternal love.
You know, that was the Browns. They happened to be singing the song Jimmy Brown, just a coincidence, from 1959, a request from one of our faithful listeners. And if you have a request or suggestion, recommendation of what you'd like to hear me discuss, or if there's something you disagree or agree with, let me hear from you. Area code 630-673-4360. All right, now, I mentioned before we took a break the possibility of going over to the blackboard. I'll just write down a few figures and just give it some thought. All right, here we are, a family earning $100,000, saving $5,000 a year, leaving $95,000 for everything else. Now, by selecting investments with good return, they assume that they can increase their rate of return by 2%. It's only $100 under $5,000. $100 of additional interest earned per year, and that saving of $5,000 by increasing the return or rate of return by 2%. Do you know what you have to do to, realistically, do you know what you have to do to increase your investment returns by a steady 2%? Very difficult. It's extremely difficult, especially if you're giving away 3 or 4% in fees. All right, but on the other hand, let's just have them reduce their expenses. Just listen to me and save some of the transferred money, just 2% of the transferred money from the remaining $95,000 by eliminating the unnecessary transfers that I talk about. Brings us back to the table an additional $1,900 a year. Not $100, $1,900. See, this is the equivalent the 1900s is equivalent to getting an incredible 38% additional rate of return on your saving. 38%. Does that ring a bell? Does that do something to you? You see, rather than taking risks with your 2% and on your $5,000 for a 2% increase, and you make $100 that you just spend at the Texas Corral next week, just 2% off your expenses, and that's what I do. Come up with an incredible 38% of additional rate of return. You ready for this? No risk, no out-of-pocket cost. It's guaranteed. Simple. See? And it's not just the transferred money that reduces your wealth. Here's the word that I've been bandied around for the last couple of years on the radio. Your opportunity cost. It's also the opportunity costs on those dollars. The cost representing the interest you could have earned on the given amount that if you had been able to avoid throwing it away or losing it or transferring it. You see, a dollar lost unnecessarily not only cost you that dollar, but it also costs you what that dollar would have earned had you not had given it away. It's not just how much you make, it's how much you're able to keep. This is another thought. You've got all kinds of plans, all kinds of concepts. Hey, this product, this club will do it, this is club will do it, this will get you to par, you'll have a handicap of 3, 5, 7. But you don't have access to your money, because access to your money is critical. In order for you to make any financial adjustment when you need it, and to take advantage of opportunity when they arise. Now, the opportunity, I'm not talking about getting in on the ground floor of McDonald's. I'm talking about, hey, listen, maybe taking advantage of some health care that's greatly needed, or your children have an opportunity to save themselves some money on a purchase. This is what I call the luck factor, right? This is the liquidity use and control, the luck. A lot of us have money tied up in retirement plans. Can I get the money? Well, there's a penalty. You got to pay the taxes. They only allow you to pay it in. They don't like it at the company when I take out the money. How about the house equity? How about the investments? Oh, house equity, I got to show that I'm able to pay it back. I got to have good credit. I've got to go through this. If I'm on disability, lots of luck in getting the money out of your home if you're out of work. You see? How about the taxes and penalties and withdrawals, the different factors that you have to go through just to have access to your money? Liquidity. When I talk about the luck factor, liquidity, use and control of your money is just as important as the rate of return on your money. You have to be able to have your money, use your money, in a collateral capacity that where it can do you some good. See, if you have an account, access to your money in an account with just a small return could potentially produce greater results over time than an account with higher returns but limited access. Do we learn that with Mr. Maloff? Do we learn it over and over and over again with individuals? Remember last week I mentioned the individual that was able to get in a 9% environment 27% on their money? Well, they guess what? They lost it all. It was a scam. They You see, come on, let's be smart about our money. Let's think about our money. Let's take a look at a few, I think, of the everyday financial issues that we've got to deal with and how our decisions concerning these issues affect us financially. See, there's taxes. Number one, we have to be concerned about the federal tax. And I mentioned this 1913. I was in an economic class one time, and I got that number wrong, and I'll never forget the correction that I received, and I can't think of the professor's name now, but it was an economic class anyway. 1913 is the 16th Amendment to the Constitution. Gave us the income tax, right? It gave us a temporary income tax. I don't know when it became permanent, but nevertheless, it was temporary. You know, things have changed since those days, haven't it? You know, no national tax system, donations from the states that they get, and social policies, of course, govern the course of the tax policy, even in the early days. The nature of these policies that didn't cross the line into attempting to equalize or redistribution of income and wealth. Just let me talk. Redistribution means that we just take it away from some and give it to others, right? Like water seeking its own level. We make everybody the same. Hey, listen, I don't care if you got up at 4 a.m, went to work, worked for 40 years, pulling a wagon, busting concrete, lifting buildings. No, we're gonna equalize everything and make it available for everybody. Forget all that. Jefferson, I got a quote that I had in the case I carry around. Jefferson wrote regarding the general welfare clause. He says to take from one because it's thought his own industry is sufficient, and that is his father's acquired too much money in order to spare or give to others who maybe their parents didn't exercise equal industry and skill, is to violate arbitrarily the first principle of association, which is to guarantee to everyone a free exercise of his industry and the fruits acquired by it. Anyway, what has that got to do with it? And I'm not going to get into the Jefferson's flat tax and the taxation. But these are some things that we should give some consideration to, or give a great deal of consideration, how we distribute our money that we have coming into our tank, and how we've handled our plan. Oh, you don't have a plan? You don't have any idea of the cash flow? You don't have a cash flow analysis? Well, then we could be certainly missing a boat, because if we didn't have that, then we're going to make an awful lot of wrong choices. And when I talk about wrong choices, I'm talking about the wealth transfers, for one, in financing our home. One house is bigger than the other one. The one's building interest, one's accumulating equity. But we can talk about that another time. Right now, I'd like to let's set our dreams a little different, huh?
A candy-colored clown they call the Sandman tiptoes to my room every night. Just a sprinkle of stardust and a whisper, go to sleep, everything is all right. I close my eyes, then I drift away into the magic night. I softly say a silent prayer, like dreamers do. Then I fall asleep to dream my dreams of you. In dreams I walk with you. In dreams I talk to you. In dreams you're mine. All of the time we're together. In dreams. But if I cry, I remember that you said thank you.
Mr. Roy Orbison singing In Dreams from 1963. If you had noticed listening to that, he spans a couple of octaves. Unbelievable how that guy's voice and his ability, just tremendous. But we talked, and I just briefly mentioned about paying off our home. Actually, when we pay off our home in the conventional way that they'd like us to do, we actually construct a third house, one for the government. But listen, owning your home free and clear, a goal, everybody wants that, okay, that's a good thing, that's apple pie, that's the American flag. But the way you pursue that goal is very important, very critical. Doing it right will increase your wealth supply by hundreds of thousands of dollars over your lifetime. Let me just leave you with these questions. How do you minimize the interest you pay on the mortgage to the mortgage company while getting the maximum tax advantage through the interest rate deductions? Do you know how to do that? Which is better, the smallest possible down payment or the largest? Is your home, the equity value in your home, a good place to keep your money? Which mortgage is better, a 30, 15, interest only, fixed, variable? What would be your choice? And can you build equity without locking up the money inside the walls of your home? Thoughts for your consideration. We've got the answers. The answers are in your plan. Oh, you don't have a plan? Couple of bucks can save you thousands and thousands of dollars, my friend. All right, let me leave you with that thought, and look forward to discussing these things with you again next week. In the meantime, have a good week. Thank you for listening. Thanks for the support of our station here at 89.7 WRHS, and look forward to talking to you next week. In the meantime, do something kind for somebody and make them smile.
When you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
and the whole world smiles with you.
Smiles with you.
And when you're laughing,
when you're laughing,
oh, you're laughing,
oh, you're laughing.
When the sun comes shining through.
When you're crying,
you bring on the rain.
Stop
your sighing, won't you be happy again?
Happy again.
When you're smiling,
when you're smiling.
Keep on smiling,
keep on smiling,
and the world will smile.
You have been listening to Wealth and Wisdom with Fred Belcastro from the John Avita Broadcast Center on Jack FM 89.7 WRHS FM Norwich and the Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network on Thursday, July the 20th, the year 2017. This broadcast was directed by John DeVita. Our special thanks to radio station manager Kevin Zeflik of WRHS-FM Norwich and the executive producer of Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network, Mr. John Shikanda. Until next time, please be safe and thanks for listening. This broadcast was pre-recorded on Wednesday, July the 19th, the year 2017. And this is Jack FM 89.7 WRHS FM Norwich, Illinois. Have a safe and enjoyable weekend, friends. See you next week.